Well, I'm here to help select 24 girls to attend the talent identification camp. This camp is to look for potential Australian players for the future. It's not really an all-star camp, but just for potential players who show a lot of character and have the talent to improve if given the right situation.
Is the camp going to be held directly after the national championships?
Yes, the girls will be announced on Friday night after the grand final, and then they will start at 9 o'clock Saturday morning, have three sessions on Saturday, two on Sunday, then they fly home.
Now, the team that you're going to pick, this special camp, is this for a representative team later on, maybe to represent Australia?
Well, we hope the girls individually will represent Australia, but no, it's not to represent Australia as a team. It is just a talent camp to look at the girls under a stress situation.
The game in progress at the moment is the clash between Western Australia and Queensland, and the match at 7:15 is between South Australia and New South Wales, and this should be the closest game of the night, and the result could go either way. And then at 9 o'clock, the big clash between Victoria Country and Victoria Metro. This will be a traditional hard-as-nails clash between the two Vic sides, and should be worth staying right to the finish of what will be a great night of basketball.
Good morning. The Australian under-17 rugby union side touring New Zealand has been beaten 21-9 by Waikato in Hamilton on its four-match tour. It was Australia's first defeat by an under-17 provincial New Zealand team in four tours. Australia's points came from a try by Sean Bergen and a penalty and conversion by Carl Skillen. Italian Tennis Open top seed Jose Higuris has staved off an upset by Australian Pat Cash in three sets in second round play. Higuris was a doubtful starter because of a shoulder sprain, but showed no signs of his injury as he battled with 17-year-old Cash to win 6-3, 3-6, 6-2. 11th seed Paul McNamee of Australia had little trouble against Italy's Paolo Bertolucci with a 6-2, 6-3 victory in the $375,000 event. Defending champion Andres Gomez didn't have as much luck though. He went down to 18-year-old Frenchman Guy Forgeau. In another upset, 19-year-old Swede Thomas Hogstead beat 9th seed Pablo Herrera of Peru. In other second round matches, Hans Gildemaster beat Jimmy Brown of the USA 6-1, 6-1. Terry Tulane of France beat Libor Pimek of Czechoslovakia 6-love, 6-4. And Eddie Dibbs of the USA defeated John Alexander of Australia 7-5, 3-6, 6-3. Ajax of Amsterdam completed a soccer double when they beat NEC Nijmegen 3-1 in the Dutch Cup final second leg match. The win gave them a 6-2 aggregate over the last two legs. 10 days earlier, Ajax were crowned as league champions. Watched by a crowd of 22,000, Ajax took the lead in the 46th minute with a goal from Gerard Vandenberg. Nijmegen protested strongly, hoping for an offside decision, but the referee allowed the goal to stand. Vandenberg added a second 7 minutes after half-time. Nijmegen came back briefly with a penalty from Henk Grim in the 60th minute. But emphatic Ajax victory was assured in the 80th minute by veteran former international Johan Cruyff. He scored from a curling volley from outside the penalty area for a distinguished end to his Ajax career. Cruyff is leaving the club on July the 1st. Two former Middlesbrough players were honoured by a testimonial match between an England side and Middlesbrough on May the 18th. Former Middlesbrough and England players Wilf Mannion and George Hardwick, who have over 40 international caps between them, were cheered by the crowd before the match began.
It was the past meeting the present. Wilf Mannion and George Hardwick, who picked up 40 international caps between them in the late 40s and early 50s, greeting the England players of today, who turned out in last night's testimonial. The crowd was well above the season's average at Ayresom Park for this long-delayed tribute. It was a night when the memories came flooding back for many of the older Middlesbrough fans.
Oh, aye, aye, Wilf and George Hardwick. But Wilf above all, he was the Wilf Mannion.
Come, we'll get up.
What was it about Wilf Mannion that made him so special?
He could read the game. He could read where the ball's come from, maybe where he's going to put it. Marvellous.
The two legendary figures watch Middlesbrough pose a few early surprises for Bobby Robson's England 11, and shortly before half-time, they took the lead. Paul Sugru finally scrambling the ball into the net. Half-time saw Mannion and Hardwick taking the centre stage. And this time, it was their turn to say thank you.
By the way, I would like to thank all you wonderful people for your support, and I appreciate it very much. I am deeply grateful. Thank you very much.
In the second half, England's Paul Walsh put pay to the Middlesbrough celebrations. Walsh's second was the goal of the night. So, a 2-1 victory for England. But the score wasn't everything. It was the occasion that mattered, and the fact that Middlesbrough had finally honoured two of their most famous players.
As you all know, the big rugby league match coming up at the International Sports Centre tomorrow is the clash between City and Country. Lee Morne caught up with the Country captain, Rocky Laurie, yesterday, and here's his report.
I'm happy to be back in the bush and very proud to be captain of this Country team. It was always a goal of mine to try and get there, and now that I've achieved, I'm very happy with it, sir.
You'll get plenty of cooperation from all sections of this team when you go out on this park on Saturday?
Yeah, the training sessions, Lee, have been very good for the... Like, players are just thrown together and they've settled in nicely, and it's going along fine.
What about the moves? City are expected to turn on some of the fancy moves we see week in and week out from Sydney coaches. Are you fellas equipped to handle all that?
Well, I think so, yeah. If I don't see that they'll put on a lot of moves. They're pretty well strangers themselves. There's some new players in the forwards and that, so I think Ted will leave it up to the individuals themselves. He's got a lot of brilliant individualists there, and I think they'll be playing a lot off the top of their head and not a lot of set moves.
You've played in representative football, really?
Oh, it certainly is, yeah. It's a fine side that, with the City players being there, the Country players will lift themselves, and you know, you may see another champion come out of the game on Saturday.
Can we wish you all the best, and certainly we're Country.
Brilliant individualists there, and I think they'll be playing a lot off the top of their head and not a lot of set moves.
Okay, you've got a good-looking pack and a very good backline. I guess you know, it's one of the best sides, I suppose, Rocky, you've played in representative football, really.
Oh, it certainly is, yeah. It's a fine side that, with the City players being there, the Country players will lift themselves, and you know, you may see another champion come out of the game on Saturday.
Once again, it was an action-packed night of basketball at the Under-18 Women's National Championships. In this game, we have Queensland in the white battling it out with Tasmania in the green, with Queensland clinching the match 97-38. In other games, Western Australia defeated the ACT 80-59, New South Wales beat Victoria Country 56-52, and the most exciting game of the night was the Victoria Metropolitan versus South Australia match, which went into 5 minutes extra time. The Victorian Metro team came out the winner 60-54. In the playoff today, Victorian Metro and South Australia will battle it out for first and second places, while New South Wales and Victorian Country will fight it out for the third and fourth places in the national championships.
Mike, as you can imagine, it is, after being at the club 5 years and now being top after so long just being in the middle, you know, middle of the table, it's great, yeah.
Is this regenerated keen interest through the KB players and the feelings running high at the moment?
Oh yeah, every player is giving 100% for the club, and as you know, we had a bit of trouble at the start of the season, but now everyone's 100% behind the club, yeah, it's fantastic.
Brisbane Lions aren't going to be easy. They beat the previous leaders of the National Soccer League, Brisbane City, last week 4-0, so it's not going to be an easy game.
No, well, no game in the National League is easy, And as he just said, they beat Brisbane City last week 4-0, so they're no mugs. It'll be a really hard game, yeah.
David, are you happy with your own 1983 form?
Yeah, I just got married, and they say, get married, your form dips a bit, but no, I'm quite happy, yeah.
David, history's being made tomorrow here at the Adamstown ground. It's the first National Soccer League game ever played here, and the ground does look in magnificent condition.
I think the pitch is in very good condition. There's a cricket pitch in the middle, which is a bit hard, but I think we'll be okay, we'll overcome that.
Dave, the big question on everybody's mind, who's going to win the FA Cup? And I suppose I should ask an ex-Englishman, who is going to win the Cup?
I come from Manchester, and I'm a City supporter, so I just thought Brighton win. This week I've been getting all mail from my mates back home in England, sending me Man United posters and song sheets of Wembley, really stirring it for me. No, I hope Brighton win.
About 12:15 in drizzling rain at the intersection of Union and Kenrick Streets, the junction. A Mazda sedan had its nose clipped at the intersection by a green Tirana. The Tirana, carrying a driver and its female passenger, skidded out of control over a footpath and through the glass door of Gary Gilmore's Sports Junction. The vehicle mowed down stock before coming to a halt at the rear of the shop. Shards of glass were sent flying by the impact. Neither occupant of the car was hurt, and the driver of the Mazda was also unscathed. It is sheer good fortune that no one was injured. A short time earlier, the shop had closed after a busy Saturday morning.
Thanks, John. Good morning, everybody. This news from Kalamazoo, Michigan, the United States, as a mouthful. Wendy Turnbull of Australia defeated Billie Jean King 3-6, 6-2, 6-3 in the singles of the Women's Tennis Classic tournament played over there. Brisbane's Winter Racing Carnival has been thrown into chaos following the decision to postpone tomorrow's Southport race meeting because of the wet weather. They're getting it up there too. The program, the first of the two-day Prime Minister's Cup meeting, was put off following an emergency meeting of the club committee very early this morning. Dorothy Case, the mother of the Brighton Soccer Cup final star Jimmy Case, collapsed and died over in England yesterday afternoon, throwing, of course, doubts now whether Jimmy Case will play in that FA Cup replay that NBN will screen on Friday morning at 4:15 a.m. and replay Friday evening at 10:15 p.m. Six West Indies cricketers are being offered contracts estimated to a total of over $3 million to play cricket in South Africa. A spokesman for the tour organisers has named the players as Viv Richards, Andy Roberts, Gordon Greenidge, Malcolm Marshall, Michael Holding and Larry Gomes. Certainly a lot of money. All six West Indies players are in the squad to tour England from June 9 to 25. Frenchman Alain Prost has coasted to victory in the Belgian Grand Prix and has now taken the lead in the World Drivers' Championship standing. He won that race from Patrick Tombay and American Eddie Cheever. He leads in the world standings from Nelson Piquet. Bowls now, and today sees the start of the TAA Claridge 7th Annual Prestige Triples at the Katara Greens. 7 international players, 24 state players in the field out there. Should be a great carnival over the next 3 days. 53 ocean yachts have left France to start the race across the Atlantic and back. 10,000 kilometres of distance, a long way. Favourites, Colt Cars and the catamaran Tag.
It is 10,000 kilometres across the Atlantic from Lorient on the coast of Brittany to Bermuda and back to France. Two of the race favourites are Colt Cars, the winner of the Round Britain race, and the Canadian catamaran Tag. Tag is skippered by Mike Birch, who came third in last year's race. Conditions were excellent for the start, but all competitors can expect rough weather in mid-Atlantic. The winner is expected back in France in just 29 days.
The Australian soccer squad to play the Englishmen here in June has been announced and contains only five players that lost those two matches to New Zealand earlier on. The team is Terry Greedy, Kim Wishart, Alan Davidson, Graham Jennings, Mike O'Shea, Steve O'Connor, David Ratcliffe, Charlie Yannox, Arno Bertogna, Jim Catt, Peter Catholis, Ken Murphy, Joe Watson, Peter Stone, Marshall Soper, Joe Cosmina, Phil O'Connor and David Mitchell. They've certainly got a job in front of them, But that looks like a pretty good side on form. That's all for this morning.
The new motor is called the C-Drive. It has a V6 configuration with a 2.6 litre capacity and it creates over 200 horsepower. It's mounted like an outboard but tilts from the top hydraulically, completely out of the water. Maintenance is easier than the conventional inboard and of course it gives much more floor space in the rear of the boat. It's manufactured by the Outboard Motor Company, which at present produces all the Johnson and Evinrude motors in Australia. Designed in America, it'll be produced here after exhaustive tests under our conditions. When it comes onto the Australian market, the OMC C-Drive will cost around $6,000. Today, we were granted this sneak preview and tested it behind a 9-meter Haynes Hunter on Salamander Bay.
Today we're having a social day to entertain the New Zealand test team, polo cross test team. They'll be playing the first test ever in Canberra at the weekend, and this is a day to give them just a little extra practice and a little better opportunity to look at the Australian conditions and players.
What is the difference between polo cross, which we're watching now, and polo?
Well, the basic difference is that polo cross is a racket and ball game, a rubber ball game, where you're throwing it around. Whereas in polo, you have a mallet and a stick and you're actually hitting the ball around the field.
The New Zealand team consists of Greg Gloyne, who is the captain, Errol Gloyne, Jim Hyland, Bernie Hyland, Bruce Stone and Clive Malcolm. And as the manager of the New Zealand team, Tom Romley, explains, one of the most difficult things confronting the visiting teams is becoming used to their new mounts. As for economic reasons, they haven't been able to bring their own horses.
This is one of the disadvantages, although we've been very fortunate in being accommodated with horses here that are perhaps of an equal. The only problem we've got is that we've got to acclimatise ourselves in a minimum of time and play top polo cross on them.
Tom, with the four teams that are competing, Zimbabwe, Papua New Guinea, New Zealand and Australia, who's going to be your toughest opposition?
I think without a doubt we've got to look at Australia. The number of years and experience of the Australians is colossal compared to ours.
Of the Windale Gateshead Major Mixed Fours tournament was won by Max Coulson's team, which comprised Barbara Wasson, Joan Paulson, Greg Winnie and Max's skipper. They defeated Ron Eacott's team in a dramatic final. The Coulson combination picked up five shots on the second last end to give them a lead of six shots going into the final end. Certainly a great finish to a tremendous tournament. At the Katara Bowling Club, the second day's play of the TAA Claridge 25's Prestige Triples tournament took place. Don Elsley of the Katara Club remains the only undefeated team after four games, but a group of six teams have won three games. They are George Oldham of Lambton, Duncan Taylor of Victoria, Ken Porter of Wallaroo, Trevor Wagner of Queensland, Jimmy Howard of Coffs Harbour and Jack Beattie of Katara. An interesting match tomorrow morning will be the clash between Howard and Wagner. This battle will be crucial to the outcome of the tournament, with Don Elsley clashing with the Tasmanian team in the morning.